today. We have a great guest in our community, Sheikh Yasser Thani, and he'll be speaking today on the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, which happened at the time of the Prophet and its relevance to today's society. Sheikh Yasser Thani was born in Houston, Texas, and he completed his primary and secondary education in chemical engineering from the University of Houston, after which he was accepted as a student to the University of Medina, where he graduated with a BA from the College of Hadith and Islamic Sciences, as well as Islamic Theology from the College of Da'wah. And then he went on to get his Master's in Aqidah. Sheikh Yasser has published works including Riyat, The Hidden Shirk, and Du'a, The Weapon of the Believer. And currently Sheikh Yasser is pursuing his doctorate in religious studies at Yale University. And he's also an Al-Maghrib instructor, and he teaches courses on Aqidah for that. So without further ado, inshallah ta'ala, Sheikh Yasser Thani.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أما بعد, I know that the timing is late, that mashallah you have just prayed a very beautiful prayer behind your imam, whom Allah Azza wa Jal has blessed with an extremely, extremely beautiful voice, as you all know, and he has studied also under some of the top Qurra in the world, so you are very blessed and fortunate to have him. And I know that it is a Saturday night, and you don't want to just spend too long in the, you know, after all of this beautiful prayer. So I'm not going to make it too long, inshallah ta'ala. Additionally, I have traveled more than 12 hours to come here, all the way from Connecticut. I didn't realize how large America was. It's actually faster for me to go to England. I go there very frequently. I get to England before I actually got to Los Angeles. So this is, subhanAllah, it's a very large country. In any case, inshallah, we're just going to give you 20-30 minutes, not more than that, about the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. And I want to mention this treaty because, in my humble opinion, out of all of the incidents of the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this one incident is probably the most relevant, the most, if you like, practical for our situation, our time and our place. There are many benefits we can extract, many wisdoms that we can comprehend immediately. And this, if we understand this Treaty of Hudaybiyah, and if we understand the ramifications of the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, really and truly it will bring about a sense of hope and optimism. Because that's what we need in the time we're living. In the times we're living, we're surrounded by matters and incidents that bring about despair, bring about sadness, bring about grief, hopelessness. The Treaty of Hudaybiyah is one of those treaties, is one of those incidents that outwardly you think also despair and hopelessness. But we find there's inner wisdoms. There we find the mechanisms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed. And so because of this, I think that we need to understand this particular incident. Perhaps out of all of the Madani incidents, this is the one incident that I think is the most relevant for us in our situation. So to contextualize, what is this Treaty of Hudaybiyah? What happened? Well, in the sixth year after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet saw a dream that he was performing tawaf around the Kaaba, and that he would shave his hair off after doing the Umrah. You know that the dreams of the Prophets are all true. They don't just dream from themselves. That's why when the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam saw in a dream he sacrificing Ismail, he knows this is a commandment, he has to do it. So here the Prophet saw a dream, he's going to Mecca, and he's doing tawaf around the Kaaba. Now hold on a sec, Mecca is enemy territory. The Quraysh are in charge of Mecca. They have tried to attack the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and kill him more than 3 times now. The Battle of Badr has taken place. The Battle of Uhud, when 2,000, 3,000 of the Quraysh marched to Medina and tried to exterminate the Muslims. The Battle of Ahzab, the trench, 10,000 Arabian soldiers, never in the history of Arabia have 10,000 soldiers gathered together under one banner. Never in the history. They gather together in order to exterminate the Muslims, and Allah Azza wa Jal each time protects them. Now the Prophet wants to walk into enemy territory. Literally, just walk in. Wearing ihram. You realize when you wear ihram, you're not allowed to wear any armor. You cannot wear anything extra apart from the two sheets. When you're wearing ihram, you're not allowed to carry weapons. Even to this day, you're not allowed to carry any type of arms if you're wearing ihram. It's one of the requirements that you cannot, that's the whole point. Ihram is a symbol of peace. It's a symbol of you want to worship Allah. So you cannot be carrying swords and shields and weapons and armor. All of this is prohibited. All that you're allowed in ihram is the sword that you will use to hunt away animals or to make sure nothing attacks you in terms of predatory beasts. As for fighting swords, this is prohibited in ihram. As for shields and weaponry, prohibited. So the Prophet ﷺ sees a dream, he has to implement it. Also realize that the Quraysh had a law from the time of Ibrahim ﷺ. And that law was Islamic. We also uphold that law. And that law is that Mecca is sacred territory. We call it in Arabic haram. From the same root as haram. Because it's haram in Mecca, it is haram to do things which are halal outside of Mecca. You cannot even hunt animals in Mecca. You cannot pluck the trees, even trees that are growing in Mecca, you cannot touch them. Wild trees that are there, it is haram to pluck those trees and get those fruits. Not the planted trees, the wild trees there. Other things are haram in Mecca that are halal outside of Mecca. So that is why Mecca is a haram. It is a holy sanctuary. Of the ramifications of this is that no person who enters Mecca should be harmed. This was a law of Quraysh, and it is a law now of Islam. Today, in our times, the Sharia tells us that if a murderer, if a criminal, if the worst person on earth, if he flees to Mecca wanting refuge in the Kaaba, it is haram for any Muslim to touch him. Why? Because Allah says, وَمَنْ دَخَلَهُ كَانَ آمِنًا. Whoever enters Mecca, he shall be at peace. The only exception is if somebody commits a crime within Mecca. If there's a criminal who does the crime in Mecca, then Mecca doesn't protect him because he violated Mecca. But if a criminal, even an evil person, does a crime, and then he turns to Allah and repents and flees to Mecca, nobody is allowed to touch him. And that is why Ibn Abbas and others, they say in the days of Jahiliyyah, a person would see the murderer of his father doing tawaf around the Kaaba. The one who killed his brother, the one who took his property, he would see that person doing tawaf, and he would not touch a hair on his head. You can't. This is in the days of Jahiliyyah. And this law was from Ibrahim alayhi salam, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Islam came and affirmed it as well. So to this day, this law is the same. Therefore, what this means is that, technically speaking, even the Muslims, if they approach Mecca in ihram, should fall under this law. The Quraysh had no right to stop anyone from performing Umrah. Yes, if they're coming with arms, with weapons, yes. But if they're coming in ihram, even from Jahili laws, they're not allowed to stop the Muslims from entering Mecca. So the Prophet ﷺ saw this dream and he said, okay, I have to implement it. Who will come with me and we're going to do Umrah unarmed? Walk into enemy territory, the lion's den. We walk in there and do Umrah. 1,400 people volunteered to do Umrah. Their trust in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Their yearning to see Mecca. They have not seen their home for 6 years now. They've been exiled. They haven't returned back. 1,400 of the Sahaba volunteered to perform the Umrah in this year. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made his way to Mecca. And when they got to Mecca, they heard that Abu Sufyan was trying to intercept them, block them from coming in. So when the Prophet ﷺ heard this, he took another path in order to outsmart Abu Sufyan. So he passed over, he went around the place Abu Sufyan was coming, and so Abu Sufyan's small contingent missed him. They're marching on towards Mecca, and they come to a plain called Hudaybiyah. It's still called Hudaybiyah to this day. It's just a plain. It's called Hudaybiyah. When they came to Hudaybiyah, the camel of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just stopped. It halted right there. And it sat down. So the Sahaba began hitting it and crying out to it, stand up, stand up. But it would not do anything. They said, hal, hal, which is what they would say to the camels, go on. But the camels refused to do anything. And the Prophet's camel's name was Qaswa. So the Sahaba said, Qaswa has become stubborn. Qaswa has become stubborn. The Prophet ﷺ replied, no, She has not become stubborn. Qaswa has not become stubborn. And nor is that a characteristic of Qaswa. I've never known Qaswa to be stubborn. No. Qaswa has not become stubborn, and neither is that a characteristic of Qaswa. Rather, the one who stopped the elephants from entering Mecca has also stopped Qaswa.